Then aftermath, the great UPA government immediately got so panicky and introduced wholesale retrospective amendments from 1-4-1962. And in fact, we were all shell-shocked, even though we were very much on the seat as law officers. I was against this wholesale amendment from 1-4-1962. In my opinion, I can boldly say, I only wanted them to make a small amendment to amend the definition of transfer, making it clarificatory that this will apply to these type of situations as well. Don't tinker with any other thing. That will take care of the situation. But the government went ahead and amended each and every section to overrule the judgment of the Supreme Court. Virtually, if you see, 214, definition of capitalism amended to clarify that property includes and shall be deemed to have always included any rights in or in relation to an Indian company, including rights of management or control or any other rights whatsoever. Definition of transfer amended to clarify that transfer includes and shall be deemed to have always been included, disposing of or parting away with any asset or interest therein, or creating any interest in any asset in any manner whatsoever, directly or indirectly, absolutely or conditionally, voluntarily or involuntarily, by way of an agreement, whether entered into in India or outside India, or otherwise, notwithstanding that such transfer of rights has been characterized as being affected or dependent upon or flowing from the transfer of a share or shares of a company registered or incorporated outside India. This is a judgment, amendment directly overruling a judgment of a Supreme Court and was challenged, rightly so, and are still pending. But this government is, even though saying that we are against all this retrospective, they have sent their AIC to support this amendment. And Section 4 have also been amended after March. In fact, as I said, Vodafone's saga is continuing. We actually, because of Vodafone, we lost Sanofi, which involved some facts slightly different, where actually two French companies acquired the shares in an Indian company. We actually dealt with the judgment of the API court in Sanofi, where shares of one French company were sold by two French companies to a third French company. The investment vehicle held shares in an Indian company, Shanta Biotech, which were indirectly transferred to Sanofi. Then that involved actually interpretation of the French, Indo-French tax treaty. But ultimately this question came whether mere transfer of shares, when actually the underlying assets are situated in India, can you overcome Section 9? API court followed Vodafone. Supreme Court has granted specially recently. And I am told leave was granted, notwithstanding the fact that the counsel for the SSE pointed out that Vodafone was followed by the High Court. But still judges doubted Vodafone and have granted leave. Therefore, I think possibly there's a chance for reconsideration. Likewise, in Aditya Birla, the Bombay High Court disregarded this Mauritian structure and held that the American company actually controlled the Indian company and did not give the benefit of the Indo-Mauritius treaty benefit to the transaction and relied upon Vodafone, and that is also pending before the Supreme Court. Both these cases, Supreme Court will consider Vodafone quite closely. But post-Vodafone, there have been widespread outrage among the investor community. I won't say investor community, but I think foreign investor community. For undoing this, investor community for undoing, but foreign investor community actually for restoring the Supreme Court judgment and making it a law. But investor community has been trying to somehow wanting to undo the judgment. Concerns have been raised regarding uncertainty and instability of laws. As I said, constitutional validity of the amendments have been challenged before the Bombay High Court in Saab Miller's and before the Calcutta High Court in McLeod Russell. And the former finance minister, Mr. Chidambaram, tried to placate investors and advocates by introducing a non-adversarial tax regime. Sri Pranab Mukherjee had sought to review the retrospective amendments by constituting the Dr. Parthasarathy Shivam Committee, which gave its recommendations. And now that's been also virtually put in the dustbin. And recently, the Bombay High Court has again followed Vodafone Qua some transfer pricing issues, and virtually have held or equated two resident entities as associated enterprises of Vodafone, and have held that the call options which we saw were not assigned to them in view of the Supreme Court judgment, and therefore there is no liability and they are not subject to any taxability or transfer pricing. Then in some recent developments, the Delhi High Court in Kopal Research considered the expression substantially occurring in explanation 5, which is introduced post these amendments by the new government, by the UPA government in 2012, and also subsequently by the new government. And this substantially, they said, would principally mean mainly or at least majority, and gains arising from sale of shares of a company incorporated overseas, which derives less than 50% of its values from assets situated in India, would not be taxable under Section 911. Therefore, now they are introducing this principle, as most OECD countries do. That is, it has to derive more than 50% of its value of assets situated in India. Then only it will be taxable under Section 911 as per COPAL. But surprisingly, even though the government also has brought this percentage in the Finance Act of 2015, as you see from the next para, they have sought to file SLP as against the Delhi High Court judgment in COPAL research. Therefore, everything is in a wholesale confusion. And there are lots of, in fact, questions which arise. As I said, from the judgment of the Supreme Court, I have already pointed out some. And on the whole, I think I would actually commend the, not because I appeared in the matter, the Bombay High Court's judgment appears to be more in consonance with the spirit of the unamended Income Tax Act, and the Supreme Court judgment has been only superficial, as it itself propounded the doctrine of look at. It has only merely superficially looked at the facts of the case. Thank you.